10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
Stop it! You're ignorant.
They're coming for you, Barbara.
Stop it! You're acting like a child.
They're coming for you.
Look, I'm cold, I'm wet, and I'm just plain scared.
I'm here. There's nothing to worry about.
How'd you do, Lyle? See, you've met Smile. Faithful hand in hand. He's just a little broad dying because when you knocked, he thought you were the candy man.
My reign of terror was legendary. Dozens of children would fall by my rage. Then the parents of Springwood came.
Coming to you live from CKLU 96.7 in Sudbury, Ontario, Canada, here's Real Music with your host OJ and special guest Rob Sacchetto.
And with a little bit of technical assistance by James, we're back on the air. Real Music. Right, James? Hey, James.
Hey, how's it going?
You haven't been here for a while?
No.
And, of course, we have Rob in the studio with us.
Rob Sacchetto here.
Yeah.
Where's my radio voice?
That's actually pretty good.
You like that?
Yeah.
I'll do that all day long if you want.
So we got Rob in the studio today. We're going to be talking movies with him, as well as he asked me if he can plug anything. I said, sure, plug away. You're doing zombies. This is our Halloween story, our Halloween show, as it were. It'll be a horrifying show, probably. But so Brad and Rob. And Rob, for some of the people out there that don't know who you are, give them a little bit of an introduction.
I'm the zombie portrait guy for the world at large. I draw zombie portraits for a living and other zombie-related illustrations for various products and things basically all over the world. And it's a living, man. It's awesome. I love it, and it's a dream come true, and I've been doing it for like 6.5 years now. It's cool.
Now, you were, I remember seeing some of your first work, not your first work, but the first time I saw your work was on the documentary that I saw on Space.
Zombie Mania.
Zombie Mania.
Yep.
How'd that come across? How'd that come to you?
That was kind of a total fluke thing, really. We were attending an event in Toronto called the World Horror Convention and in this hotel. And at the time, we didn't know that it was mainly a literary convention, but we had been booked in, and, you know, I do drawings, right? So I'm this, like, illustrator guy, and there's, like, no illustrator guys there. It was just, you know, writers. And it was a total bust. It's kind of funny because I could have had a real zombie there and no one would have paid me any attention at all. So it was kind of brutal. But What happened was the crew for this documentary, Zombie Mania, ended up being there, and my wife at the time ended up talking to them kind of by chance, and they said, oh, you know, this guy's doing the zombie stuff, like, let's interview him. So they took me back to their hotel where they had everything set up and ended up doing this interview with them. Like, it was lit, and they had, like, all this zombie, like, my zombie stuff behind me and all this stuff. It was really cool. Like, they actually set me up. And so we did that. It was a lot of fun. I was kind of half in the bag, actually, when I did it, to be honest, because at the end of the day, at this, like, World Horror Con, I was kind of, like, you know, in the dumps. I'm going, wow, I'm taking a bath on this. So, you know, started having a few drinks and whatever, and then all of a sudden this happened. So back at their hotel, doing this interview. And then afterwards, kind of didn't think really anything of it for a couple months, I guess, while they were doing more production and interviewing, like, Romero and Nicotero, Greg Nicotero and everything. Then they ended up emailing me and asking me if I would do illustrations of all of the people that they were interviewing, including myself, as zombies that they would morph in during the interview on the show. So I ended up doing that, and it came out, and it was really cool. So that's how that kind of ended up happening.
That's really cool.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Now, have you always been interested in zombies and stuff like that, like, from a young age?
Oh, yeah.
Just always up to now?
Pretty much ever since I was, like, 10, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, right into the zombie stuff. Monsters in general. Like, I was a big fan of Godzilla movies and monster movies in general. So, yeah, kind of, you know, it's always been there. It's always been in my life, type of thing. Yeah,
yeah, you can tell because the listener doesn't get to see this, but you can see the joy in his eyes when he talks about zombies. And in the studio, I just noticed this above his head is the only Halloween decoration with the skull and everything else. So I thought that was kind of funny.
It's totally planned.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, well, since we're a show about movies, I figured, and you're our first guest. That's confirmed. And shown up. I figured, you know, the first question I'd ask that's related to the show is, what's your favorite movie?
Favorite movie? Wow. That's a huge one. It's tough to say. I've got, like, a top five.
Share the top five with us.
Favorite movie of all time? That's a hard one. I think the top five would probably be a good place to start. And I think there's, like, so many. Like, there's so many flicks out there that I dig. Like, Heat, you know, was, like, one of my favorite movies for a long time. Glengarry Glen Ross, like, you know, another huge movie. Like, a lot of the movies, some of the movies that I really like aren't even horror movies. You know, jeez, let's see. Where do we even start with that? Like, Kung Fu Hustle. That was, like, that, like, you know, blew my mind. The Crow, you know, at the time, blew my mind. I still love that movie to this day. You know, The Exorcist. Like, just, like, such, you know, so groundbreaking, so memorable. The Godfather trilogy, man. Like, you know, I could, you know what, I could just sit here and go on and on forever with favorite movies. Like, I'm a huge movie buff.
Yeah.
I mean, I could sit here all day.
All day?
No, yeah.
We only have an hour and a half.
Strap yourself in.
Okay, then I'll narrow it down just a bit more. What was your favorite movie of this year so far?
Even that one's a tough one. I just saw Antichrist, which was, like, really good, really astonishingly well done, surprising, with Willem Dafoe. I don't know if you've heard of it or seen it. Great, great flick.
Yeah.
Lars von Trier directed that. Let's see, Red State. Did I see that this year? I think I saw Red State this year. Loved it.
Yeah.
Really great movie. I saw this Indonesian movie this year, too. It's a horror movie called Macabre, whatever. fantastic horror movie, like really, really good. Boy, what else have I seen? See, I like to watch really good things and really crappy things too. Like I saw Drive Angry. Like I actually picked that up so I could have a new like shittiest movie ever in my collection, you know. And it did not disappoint. It was horrible. You know, what else? Jeez. I think like the new Batman flick like was tremendous. Like it was fantastic. I loved it. Avengers, man. Like there's so many things I see that I kind of forget. Like right after I see it, it's like because I am very busy right now. It's kind of like I don't think of stuff like after I see it that much. I see it, I love it, and then it's right back to work. So, those movies right there, you know, in the top, I don't know, I guess 10 type thing. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So did the, you remember Dark Knight Rises?
Yes.
Did the 8 years of him not being Batman affect you?
You know what? Yeah, I thought that was kind of weird. It's almost like, you know, in this new Batman sort of trilogy, he's only done, like, Batman stuff 3 times, you know?
Yeah.
And it kind of narrows the whole him being Batman down to, like, 3, like, occasions where he's done anything. And that's kind of weird. Like, that when you kind of think about it, that's kind of strange. That's a kind of strange thing. You think Batman is like everywhere, all the time, doing stuff, fighting crime, and you know this trilogy would have us believe that he only did 3. There was only 3 real huge events in his life.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, it was kind of weird.
So like it was sort of like I was looking at it, and I think a couple weeks ago I rewatched right from Batman Begins.
Yeah.
And then Dark Knight, and. Batman Begins, he wasn't Batman until about halfway through the movie.
Yeah.
You know, he was in the get up, like the mugger and the Balclava and everything.
Yeah.
For a brief moment, and then he got the suit and everything.
Yeah.
And then at the end of the movie, he gets given leaves a trademark, and you see the Joker card.
Yeah.
So you know that you knew that the Joker was going to be the next villain. And it comes in, and it's almost like. The time lapsed was like almost like to an aspect to the release of the films.
Yeah.
Like that, like almost like real time type of thing.
Yeah, right.
And then he's Batman, and because people are imitating as well, so you know that time is there, and he's been fighting and everything. But then when it comes to the point where, well, my girlfriend died, I don't want to be Batman anymore. You know, like the emo. Bruce Wayne in the beginning of Dark Knight Rises, like you're in your 30s. Like,
yeah.
You still have time. Because I was telling James earlier, like, we do a podcast Saturday mornings and he puts it up, whatever. We were talking about it too a few times. And the fact that the Dark Knight Rises was based or inspired by 3 Batman stories.
Okay, yeah, right. Yeah.
Obviously the Bane one.
Yeah, yeah.
When I first saw the trailer on when it was on Avengers, I see the bridges just.
Yeah, right,
that,
right.
That remind right away. Like I was with my wife the first time, then I was with her family the second week.
Right.
And then the third, I saw it 3 weeks in a row.
And which Batman story comic book wise was that sort of based on? That was based off
them being blocked off. Yeah. From the rest of the country was a storyline called No Man's Land.
Right. Yes, that's right. Yeah.
And then. On top of that, the 8-year gap was taken from The Dark Knight Returns.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Frank Miller story.
Yep, yep.
But he was retired. He was, like, he's in his 50s in that.
So oh, yeah, it's futuristic.
Him,
yeah,
so
yeah.
So, yeah.
Plus, the weird thing, too, I thought was, like, Gotham in the first movie, you know, Batman Begins, was, like, a futuristic city. Like, they had this monorail going through it and stuff.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the second one was more like I mentioned earlier, Heat, the movie Heat. It was like Heat and with Batman in it.
Yeah.
You know, it was like super gritty, realistic, and, you know, no sort of hints at futuristic stuff, unless it came to his, you know, like contraptions and gizmos and things, which they didn't go over the top, which was great.
Yeah.
Like, you know, turn him into like a schlocky, like the first sort of franchise, I guess. Like, yeah, the less talked about that, the better.
Now, of course, the two blockbusters of the summer did have something in common. The Avengers and Dark Knight, they both had a Playboy millionaire.
Billions.
Go off into the distance with the nuclear device and blow up.
Yeah, holy crap, I never really... See, this is what I mean by I forget things, you know? Yeah. So, but it's true, yeah, man. Yep.
So, I don't know, James, you've been talking too much today, so...
Shut up. Shut up.
But we're gonna just take a little bit of a musical interlude with a track from Danny Elfman. We like to play, not to play like blockbuster songs, like from blockbuster movies or anything, like the songs themselves.
You play the Simpsons intro?
No. But we do play the score.
Okay.
So for this year one, we're going to listen to the score from, make sure I got it on right, Beetlejuice.
Oh, excellent.
So we'll give that a listen, and we'll be right back after that with Rob and James. Maybe he can have a few words in.
Pipe in.
So have a listen. And we're back. And that was Danny Elfman. With a theme song from Beetlejuice. So we're back in the studio with myself, OJ, and James.
And James, yeah.
James, and of course we have our guest, Rob.
Hello.
Funny story too is, I always had trouble trying to say your last name, and to describe to people like, oh, you have a guest? You're gonna have guests on your radio show? Yeah. Yeah, he's Rob. The zombie guy. So it's like, what? You're going to have Rob Zombie on the show? I was like, no. He does these zombie portraits.
You will be disappointed.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because I usually, like, I create the intro. So I was like, OJ, I'm going to create an intro for the show. I create it, and I was like, I think we'll just roll with this one intro the whole time. It's like, but it's becoming common practice for... For OJ to say, can you do this? Can you do that?
The first one we changed, we have like a regular opening. And beginning of the month, there was the 50th anniversary of James Bond.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
And we did a James Bond show. And I asked us to do that. And it was fitting, too, because I really wanted to say Bond. I'm Bond. You know, in my mind, I really wanted that perfect out. And he did it.
But you didn't. Perfect. Yeah, but you didn't tell me.
No. All the sound bites from the different. Yeah.
Well, what I do is I go on YouTube and I get the sound clips.
Yeah, yeah.
But there happened to be this one that was showed them after. There's happened to be one that was a 10-minute video, and they were all just clips, all jam packed together.
Yeah,
so I'm like, hey, why make work? He's already creating work for me.
Yeah, yeah.
So speaking of stuff on the internet, we're gonna put the show on my podcast feed.
Yeah.
AnotherPodcast.com.
Awesome.
So it's ehanotherpodcast.com. And we're going to put the show on, Rob, on Friday. It's a special, I forget what I call it exactly. But we'll put it on, and I'll get your information after.
Yeah.
After you pimp yourself here, we'll put all your stuff on there.
Yep.
And it goes up on the internet. We put it on Facebook. OJ shares it. I share it.
Beautiful.
A whole bunch of people share it.
Awesome.
And all... And
so it'll be seen by like
5 people.
10 people.
No.
Yeah.
Since I started doing it, I get about 300 views or so.
Oh,
so
cool.
It works out pretty good. And a lot of it has to do with the people that I talk to, like OJ. And then he shares it. And then a couple of other friends. So
I will do my best.
Yeah, we're hopefully a good showing for you. And then, you know, everything works out. Now I had a question.
Yeah.
So you draw zombie portraits.
Yes.
Anybody ever come to you and say, can you draw me a zombie and I want to get a tattoo of it? And how do you feel about that? Like, that's kind of like almost like if a tattoo artist was taking your drawing, it would feel like stolen artwork to me anyways.
That happens incredibly often. Also, what happens is on the zombie portraits, the www.zombieportraits.com website, there is a division of zombie portraits called Zombie Daily, in which I post a new original zombie drawing or painting every single day. I know that sounds insane. You know, when you wrap your head around it and think about it, yeah, it is crazy. But I've been doing that for consecutively for over a year and a half, and then far earlier than that, but a little more sporadically. Only because when I get a huge project to do, like a book cover or something else, I'll have to I'm doing the book cover and then zombie portraits, and then you know the zombie daily stuff will have to sort of go on the shelf for a bit unless I have a bunch of stuff in a queue, for example, mm-hmm. to put up every day. So if I don't, it has to go on a hiatus for maybe a month or a couple weeks or whatever. That part of zombie portraits is a thing that basically people just go to, and it's quote stolen from very often for people to make tattoos. But the nice thing is, a lot of times people will ask me if they can use it for a tattoo first, mm-hmm. and literally 9 times out of 10, I'll say yeah, of course. And what they do is they'll usually take photos of the tattoo that they've done of my art and send it to me, and I'll post it. So, which is cool. It gives me a little bit more content too. Mm-hmm. I don't post it instead of an original art piece of art, but I'll post it, as an accompaniment or, put it on my Facebook fan page or something. Mm-hmm. So it happens all the time.
Yeah. I guess it's kind of flattery, eh? If someone's taking your drawing and putting it on their body and someone else is tracing over it, it's flattery to yourself.
It is, for sure, but I've noticed a lot, on Facebook, there's a trillion, zombie pages, right, that have, millions of images culled from the internet, mm-hmm. and I find that I'm, probably one of the most stolen from guys out there, because I've got almost 1,400 images on Zombie Daily that people can peruse. So that's a lot of images, man.
Yeah.
And it's all content that's specifically for that site. It's not sometimes I'll put, stuff from a book or stuff from a project or whatever on there, but most of the stuff is done specifically for that site, so it's just new, fun zombie drawings, man, or paintings.
Cool.
Yeah.
You want to, I noticed that you have a ongoing project, which is your graphic novel.
Oh my god, yeah, that has been 20 plus years in the making. It's a 150 page graphic novel called Rob Sacchetto's Cape Fear, and it's we're looking for funding right now. We're really getting up there, but we need a lot of support still. And that's at indiegogo.com/cape-fear. And if you go to that, you'll be able to contribute to getting that published. And it's not a handout, it's not a donation. Basically what it is a pre-order. So I think, anywhere from $25 to $35 gets you an actual copy of the book. Plus, I think an original art piece aside from that, and a digital copy. The perks are insane for what you actually pay, it's a pre-order. It's not like oh, you're just giving me money for something, and get nothing back. You actually get the book, and it's 150 pages, man, huge, and it's taken me a long time to do it, but it was a lot of work, but I think it's really great. I really beg the support of people to help me see have that see the light of day. All the pages are done. Everything's done. It's lettered. It just has to be sort of composed and everything as a graphic novel. So it'd be a shame to see that kind of sit in my filing cabinet for the rest of, for forever instead of having, an actual copy of it or see it be published. So anything anyone can do to help out that thing, see the light of day, would be appreciated big time, yeah.
So when did you set up your, it's not Kickstarter, it's the other thing.
It's Indiegogo. Yeah, Indiegogo.
Yeah, because Kickstarter is a little bit different. I've heard about people doing Kickstarters. Yeah. Help me make my movie, but then you never hear of it, right?
Yeah.
Or whatever else. A friend of mine in the UK did a vinyl album. He's a musician.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And what he did something very similar to you, and what he did was you were buying the copy of it because it was like an advanced copy.
Yeah.
And he wasn't using it to make – well, he was using it to make the album, but it was more like this is how much money I need to make this number of albums.
Yeah.
And you get special credit on it as like, you know, helped, you know.
Yeah.
And it that's what it reminded me of. It was just the exact same thing.
That's the
– it's not a waste of the money, the person's money. It's like, hey, you'll get a copy. You're getting – this
correct
yeah. back
that's exactly what yeah. it is. It's a lot of times people have the misconception that it's a donation, you know, because when you say, you know, help support it, it sounds like a donation, but what it is in actual fact is you're basically buying it, so you're creating a fan base for it. This is the beauty part of the Indiegogo and Kickstarter thing. You're creating the fan base and the product at the same time, mm-hmm. which is brilliant. So you know, a lot of times with you know, you mentioned the movie thing. A lot of times the reason why you don't see it is because a lot of these things are all or nothing campaigns where if they don't meet the money that they're asking for, it's not done.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm asking $3,500 to get this done, so it's nothing really.
Yeah.
Where a lot of the movie ones are like, you know, they're asking for $150,000,
mm-hmm.
and you know, their campaigns last 6 months. This is only, I think there's 37 days left in this one, and we're almost halfway there. So, like, it's, you know, a clutch cargo gig now, man. Like, you know, it's getting right down to the wire. So if anyone out there wants to see this thing, and it's a Sudbury-based thing, it's coming from Sudbury, it's, like, being produced just by me. Trying to put Sudbury on the map again, you know, with art and everything. So, yeah, you know, the support is really needed, absolutely.
Sounds awesome.
Well, that's enough about me.
Yeah. we're getting at that time where we have to do some station identification. So, of course, you're listening to CKLU 96.7.
I'll let him do it in the radio voice.
Yeah, you want to say it?
Oh, God. I don't do tricks, man.
But, yeah.
You're listening to CKLU.
Yeah,
there we go. That's pretty good.
And this,
I like that.
Yeah. It's Real Music with, I'm OJ.
I'm James.
And of course we have
Rob Sacchetto.
Yeah, there, see, that's how you pronounce it.
Yeah, like that.
Yeah, you gotta say it like that.
Yeah. So I'm gonna have a sound bite, I'm gonna have it on my iPod or something like that, and every time I mention it, and it's gonna have a sound bite of him saying,
that's gonna get annoying real fast.
What happened was, when I created the intro,
yeah.
I was like, so, how do you say his name? I don't know.
Yeah.
It's hard.
And it's like, yeah, like I said to you earlier, it's like my brain knows how to say it,
yeah.
but my mouth doesn't want to say it, and it's afraid to say it wrong.
Yeah.
You know?
I will spell it phonetically. Yeah.
He says, I think there's a YouTube video on how to say it properly.
that's good.
I was like, yeah, I think we'll be fine. I'll just try this. If it's wrong, he can tell me after.
Yeah. So, obviously, if you're listening to us on the radio, you know what channel we're on. We're on 96.7 FM. If you ever are listening, if you want to listen to us online, you can go to cklu.com, .ca, and we are screaming. No, we're streaming.
Streaming
online for today's
episode.
Oh, we will
be streaming soon.
Oh, yeah. This is our Halloween episode with Rob and. Can't get that sound bite out yet.
Sacchetto, Leto,
there we go. And of course this is our Halloween episode, and of course streaming online, but screaming.
Oh yeah,
screaming online.
So, we're about movies, and figure there's a lot of movies out there, and the one thing I love going to the movies. To the theater, is not going to see a movie, but going to see the trailers.
Oh, God, yeah.
And this week, I didn't have to go to the theaters to watch some good trailers. This week, they released, back on Tuesday, actually on Facebook, they had this Iron Man app where enough fans who liked it, there was this bar, like a recharging bar underneath it, and once it got to 100%, they would release a tease of the trailer for Iron Man 3.
Freaking Hollywood, eh?
So
they know how to do it.
It didn't happen slow, that's for sure. So on Sunday, they released a bit of a tidbit of it. And then on this past Tuesday, they released the full trailer. And it's, like, you watch some of the what they call Phase 1, which is starts off with Iron Man, goes into Incredible Hulk, Iron Man 2, Thor, Captain America. That's what they consider Phase 1. Now, I like to look at it as a Iron Man was first. Thor is in there somewhere, like him on Asgard. But then in Iron Man 2...
Are you talking about sort of the progression of how the movies...
Yeah, and the storyline itself.
Oh, right,
the way
okay.
The way the continuum as it
sure,
were.
Sure.
And in Iron Man 2, he mentions Coulson.
Yeah.
Mentions that he's got to go to New Mexico.
Right, yeah.
And then the end credits scene has him showing up.
With the hammer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not giving too much away.
No.
Because no one's really seen it yet.
Yeah. I'd like to call this show spoilers, but yeah. There's not a show called that. So, but at the end of Iron Man 2, they showed... Nick Fury and Tony Stark he's having his final report, whatever, with in this makeshift warehouse base of S.H.I.E.L.D. And on one of the screens, you can actually see news footage of the incident that happened at the Berkeley that happened in The Incredible Hulk with Edward Norton.
Oh, yeah, yeah, okay.
So
okay.
Even that, like Iron Man 2, and The Incredible Hulk overlaps Iron Man 2, and then Thor... Captain America obviously is the first one, so that goes all the way back to the 40s.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know? But now with the Iron Man 3, it's established that, okay, we're in the Phase 2 now, so now it's, we're starting, as it were, from zero again type of thing. But right off, almost like right after the events of the Avengers.
So I say bring on Guardians of the Galaxy.
That'll
confuse that. Shit out of
every
year, eh? Yeah, it's a couple years.
Did you read that?
Couple years?
Did you read about that?
In a couple years?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, no, I read.
Same summer as the new Captain America.
Yeah, it's.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's not next year; it's the year after.
Yeah,
right.
But they also announced that.
So like 2016,
2015. 2014, Guardians of the Galaxy.
They really?
Yeah. Iron Man. The next Iron Man comes out next year.
Yeah. Yeah.
April.
May. Okay.
In the trailer, it says April.
Yeah.
Only because it's the UK.
Oh,
so
yeah.
They get a week before.
Yeah.
For us, and even that, the red carpet will be like in the beginning of April as
sure,
well.
Sure. Yeah.
Then November of next year sees the new Thor movie.
Right.
With they replaced one of the characters, the actor. One of the actors.
Heimdall.
It's one of the.
The guy who played the Punisher there in Warzone?
He's still in it.
I love that guy.
But and not the Asian guy, but yeah. The third guy.
Okay.
He almost looks like Robin Hood.
Yeah.
They replaced him with Chuck. You ever see the show Chuck?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Zachary Levi.
Yeah, right, yeah.
So he's being replaced in that one.
Does anybody really care, though? Like, I mean, you know, those are kind of characters that... Well, I don't know, like... Are you gonna go? Hey, that's not the same guy.
That's true. Yeah, because they didn't really see that much of him anyway.
Yeah.
And then in, I think it's April of 2014, is the next Captain America movie, which is called The Winter Soldier.
Hmm.
And then August, it was rumors going around that it was gonna be Doctor Strange.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Or something else. And then there was also Guardians of the Galaxy. So Guardians of the Galaxy comes out August of 2014.
Has anyone been sort of courted for the Doctor Strange role? Or do you know anything about that?
There was rumors, and we had mentioned on the show as well, because they came out, the rumors came out the week of our show, one of our shows, that Doctor Strange was actually going to make an appearance in Thor. Dark World.
That'd be cool. That'd be so cool. I love Doctor Strange.
And the actor attached to the rumor was Viggo Mortensen.
Oh, no!
Yeah.
Okay, that... You know, so, I was going to say Guy Pearce would be great, but Viggo would be fantastic as Doc Strange.
Yeah.
That would be amazing.
So now, of course, they debunked that. They said, no Doctor Strange. But then again, they also... there was something they... someone said, I don't believe stuff like that where they debunked the rumor, because they said that, what's her name? The actress from Inception, when she was in Dark Knight Rises.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
She wasn't going to be playing Talia al Ghul.
Right, right.
They went right into it. They cast her as this one character, a CEO or whatever, and said, no, I'm not playing Talia. I'm playing this other character, totally different. Watch the movie. They're involving Ra's al Ghul's son? No, he doesn't have a son. He's got a daughter, you know. So
I was totally surprised when she kind of, you know,
the big reveal.
Yeah, I didn't see it, I really didn't see it coming. I didn't think about it. I like to go to a movie and you know turn my brain off and just be entertained, or at least try to. And you know, when that happened, I was like, wow. She stuck it to him.
Yeah.
You know, it was
literally.
Yeah. It was great. I thought it was great.
Yeah. And so, and then after all these solo movies of Captain America, they've already got all directors. Iron Man, I think, is either they're done production or they're going to be done soon. Thor is still in production. Captain America, they go into production next year. And they've already signed people to it. We've mentioned it before. I'll let you know what Anthony Mackie is going to be playing the Falcon.
Who is that?
He is the African American actor from what was it? Oh, the Adjustment Bureau.
The Adjustment Bureau. Oh, I never saw that.
No.
Any good?
That's good.
Really?
Yeah, I liked it. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Pretty good story.
Yeah.
And then they also obviously they re-signed. Sebastian Stan? Is that his name? He played Bucky.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
I think that's his name.
Yeah.
Barnes. James Barnes in the first one.
Yeah.
But when I watched it like the opening night I was there, and it was funny, too. People joke with me, and it's like, oh, why'd you do that? It's like, because I wanted to see it. my brother took me with my sister, and it was a night before my wedding.
Yeah.
So it was like my bachelor party.
You geek!
Hey!
I'm not a geek.
Yeah. So like, and my wife said, like, well, why don't you just wait till we're back? It's like, we're not gonna be back for like a week. You know, after it comes out, it's like I want to see it.
And by then you would have seen all the spoilers everywhere popping up,
exactly,
and you would have been like,
yeah,
no.
That's geek career suicide.
Yeah,
you can't do that.
So when I first saw it, and James, you saw it?
What? Captain America? Yeah.
And you saw it too.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And where there's a scene in it where they do the whole montage of like just after they rescue Bucky.
Yep.
And
that was cool.
And he was like separated. From everybody.
Yeah, right.
You know, so I was thinking what they were doing, why he was there. I was thinking, how much did they do to him?
Yeah, exactly, Because
then you see the montage of all of them getting into the warehouses and destroying everything.
Yeah.
Then they get to the train scene, and he falls into the ravine.
Yeah, clearly there's something at work there.
You know, and it's like a ravine, a river, and it's wintertime.
It's icy.
It's like,
yes.
I wonder what they're going to do. And then at Comic-Con, when they announced it, it's like Winter Soldier. It's like, I knew it.
Yeah.
I knew it. You know?
Geek senses tingling.
Yeah. So just after Comic-Con, with all these dates, they also announced the release date for the sequel for the Avengers, which is May 2015.
Wow. Already, eh?
And they announced that, and then almost like, they delayed it a bit, but they announced the director and writer, Josh Whedon, would be coming back on board.
Amazing.
As well as a untitled TV series.
Oh, right. With
A week after that, they like dragging out this news. And then like a week after that, it's like, yeah, we're doing S.H.I.E.L.D. It's called S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah, that's right. I heard about that. Yeah.
And then there's all these speculations of who's going to be on there, because it's going to be taking place in that same world, the Marvel cinematic world. And
which is great.
Yeah.
Business-wise, too, for them. Yeah.
Because they can incorporate, because there was a short, I don't know if you've seen the the Blu-ray of the Avengers
yet? No, but I remember you mentioning it.
Yeah, they have a short on them. They started doing it with Thor, and he did these Marvel one shot
on Agent Coulson, right?
Well,
was it?
The first two one shots were with Agent Coulson.
Yeah.
One was called The Consultant.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Which had to do with leading up to Tony Stark's appearance in The Incredible Hulk.
Yeah.
And then the second one was, it was called A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to New Mexico.
Yeah.
And it's him leaving Iron Man 2 and showing up, and he's he shows his action. Like, he stops a robbery, whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So with the Avengers now, they did one where it's in the aftermath of the Avengers, and it's called Item 47.
Okay.
And it is these two people find this, one of these weapons that fell from the sky after they defeated the, what are they called? James? Squirrel?
Squirrel. No, I was thinking, I'm getting some for later.
For the enemies, whatever, and then all these weapons, but this one was
missing. Oh, the Chitauri? Yeah, right.
And they, for some reason, they got it working. So they end up doing all these robberies.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And then they get one guy.
So how long are these segments, anyway?
Probably like 8 minutes.
Yeah, they're not very long.
So they cover a lot of story.
Oh, yeah.
And
then they end up coming back, and he gets the agent that goes out, the other S.H.I.E.L.D. agent that gives him the assignment, calls him Coulson. Now, the movie's been out in theaters, breaking records. It's out on DVD and Blu-ray, breaking records. So this is not going to be a spoiler to anybody. But in the movie, Coulson seemed like he died.
Yeah.
Because Loki, with his Loki pokey stick, stabs him from behind. On the UK DVD of it, they took away the blade.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah, you can see it on YouTube if you look.
What, so George Lucas come in and change it up? And
yeah, Darth Vader shows up and says, no!
So, yes. So they did that. And I'm thinking, I told everybody, even going into, like, when it was coming to theaters, so, you know, like, they can't kill him off.
No.
You know, because, for one, he's doing the voice. Clark Gregg is the actor. He just started doing the voice of Agent Coulson on Ultimate Spider-Man, the new cartoon series.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
From Disney XD.
Yeah.
And he just started doing that voice. They just introduced his character into the comic books. Just this past year.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yep.
See, I got away from the comic book stuff. I just can't keep up with it, man.
And
every couple weeks is a new, like, number one issue.
And the fact that in the movie, they said that with his cards that he's got of Captain America with blood on them.
And
Agent Hill says that those weren't, they were in his locker.
Yeah, right, right.
And Fury says, they needed a push.
Yeah, yeah.
So, a few weeks ago, they announced at New York Comic Con that they have signed Clark Gregg, Agent Coulson, to star in the Marvel S.H.I.E.L.D. TV series.
So they can't really kill him off.
So, yeah, but is it going to be like a lead up to everything?
No, that's the thing, too. Yeah, it's like, now people are like starting to root that it's going to be flashbacks. Is it going to be like a prequel?
Yeah.
It's like, he's not dead.
You know what?
It might be a different division. You know how big that helicarrier is?
Yeah, totally. I heard things about him being coming back as the Vision.
That's another thing, too.
You know? So there's that. I mean, when you look at him, he could totally be the Vision man.
Yeah.
If they go with the traditional look of how the Vision looks in the comics.
Yeah.
The Vision, by the way, for people who don't know, is an android that is one of the Avengers in the comic books. You haven't seen him yet in the movies, but
and do you know
Hank Pym?
And they haven't created that character yet in cinematic yet.
Right, right.
At Comic Con, they showed footage.
Oh, see,
Edgar Wright has been working 6 years on this movie. Edgar Wright, the director of Hot Fuzz,
Shaun
of the Dead,
yeah.
Scott Pilgrim.
Yeah.
He's been trying to develop it off and on with his partner, and they released some test footage. They just recently greenlit it, and it's coming out the same summer as The Avengers.
Yeah, I heard about that, too. Yeah.
So, we might see Ant-Man, or Hank, as it were,
yeah,
in The Avengers 2, and then develop into Ant-Man.
Yeah.
And then it also would probably include Vision in there as
because
well.
Because he also created Ultron, which is like one of the best Avengers villains ever.
Yes.
Which
and that's how Vision came about.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah, so like, you know, and Wonder Man,
of course.
You know, so yeah. Anyway,
while we're talking about the Avengers,
okay,
and Iron Man's coming back, right?
Yes,
next year. Have you seen the photos of Ben Kingsley as the Mandarin?
Oh yeah,
did you see that?
Amazing.
Yeah,
yeah.
Did you see the tattoo on his back?
I didn't see that. No.
Well, he's in the trailer.
Yeah, yeah.
He's in the trailer.
Did you see the he's got a tattoo on the back of his neck.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It looks like Captain America's shield.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, what the, yeah, that's kind of weird.
So that's going to be something to see, and that's a big reference to the first Iron Man movie.
But, yeah, I was going to say, didn't they sort of do the Mandarin in the first Iron Man movie
sort of
way?
Yeah. It was part of the this group called the Ten Rings.
Yeah.
That's what the terrorist group was called.
Yeah.
That one guy who is...
Maybe they're going to reveal him to be the leader that you never really saw or something. Okay.
Yeah. So
that would make sense.
It was funny too because the actor who plays that that isolated group of the terrorist group, the two that you see, the guy in the beard.
Yeah.
He plays later on. I saw him in Adam Sandler movie called You Don't Mess with the Zohan. And he played one of the cabbies, and and then the other guy, who's the bald guy, and he's clenching the ring. He's like the
The main bad guy, yeah.
He's actually, he got postponed from this past summer, and now it comes out in March this coming year. He's actually behind the mask of Cobra Commander in the new, next G.I. Joe movie.
Oh, yeah. When's that coming out?
It was supposed to come out in June.
Yeah.
They postponed it because of... they said that they had to do reshoots. I'm thinking in my mind, Avengers, Spider-Man, Dark Knight Rises, you're going to be postponing it.
You know, it's funny you mentioned Spider-Man. I barely remember watching that movie. I went to see it at the theater, and I don't know. It didn't have a huge impact on me.
So you spaced out while you were watching it?
No, not at all. I was trying to get right into it, and like I do when I go to the theater, I try to get right into the flick, and... it's a good way to, because I'm not at home watching it, I don't have any distractions, so I'm like, there. And I don't know, it didn't blow me away.
The majority of that movie was filmed, wasn't really filmed 3D.
Was it?
Yeah, it was 3D. I
don't think I saw the 3D version of it, though.
You see it in Sudbury?
I saw it in Sudbury, yeah.
So you didn't see it in 3D?
I don't know.
Okay, so it wasn't AVX.
Yeah, no.
Because that's an expensive ticket. To see a 3D movie in AVX, that's an expensive ticket.
You know what? It was just timing, eh? Like,
yeah.
I mean, I don't kind of premeditate things too far in advance. I kind of just go when I have time. So, I just went to see the next available one that was there. And, I don't know. But you know what? When you asked me what one of the best movies I've seen this year was... I forgot to mention Cabin in the Woods.
That was a good one, too.
Cabin in the Woods blew my...
Did you see it?
I haven't seen it yet.
My ever-loving...
He has been on the show for a couple weeks.
And you call yourself a geek.
Yeah, you asked me a couple weeks ago if I saw it. And I said, not yet.
That one, again, was...
I think I'm watching it tonight.
With Josh Whedon.
Yeah.
He was a producer on that one. Yeah. As well as, I think it was the director of... No.
And Chris Hemsworth was in that, too.
Yes, and that was...
He's in everything this year.
I believe that was before he started doing Thor.
Is that right?
Yeah, it was 3 years.
Yeah, it took three years.
So he went from there, he went from, they filmed that in Vancouver, or in British Columbia.
Yeah.
And then he went, then he got announced to be it. And it's like, Josh is like thinking to himself, like, yeah, I can see you as Thor. Like, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then you see even that, the same summer when they announced everybody on board, he's like, overtowering everybody.
Who, Chris Hemsworth?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's a monster. But, that movie was fantastic. And you know what? Every once in a while, Hollywood lets a good flick, you know, slip by, and that was it for that for this year, I think.
Yeah.
Or was that last year?
It was last year. Yeah.
It just came out a few weeks before the Avengers.
This year. And now it's released on DVD.
Yeah, it's on DVD right now.
And Blu-ray.
I love the fact that the concept behind it, the fact that they have five people.
Yeah, it's
going out to a cabin.
Yeah,
it's standard.
Yeah,
but you watch it right from the beginning.
It's Evil Dead.
Yeah, but you watch it right from the beginning. It's like, am I in the right movie?
Yeah,
because you can start off with Richard Jenkins and they're in an office or whatever.
Oh, like, just well, so well done.
Yeah,
so well done, man. Lots of surprises, stuff you never see coming. And you know what? As a 10-year-old boy, which I am, seeing that was amazing because I love monsters, man. And when you see this, you'll see monsters. And
like literally,
you
like
will not be disappointed with
like
the monster,
I like the fact that they try to be creative with their. Some of them were like.
Rip-offs.
Creative rip-offs.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like Pinhead.
Yeah, sure.
And,
sure.
And the zombies, all
Cenobites. The Cenobite type guy. They had the ring type girl. They had, like, you know, those sort of archetypes of horror genres. But then they had, like, you know, some really creative things, which, you know, not really going to get into because it'll be, you know, better left sort of surprised when you watch it. Great flick. Just watch it. If you like horror, if you like just even a good movie, just watch it. It's fantastic.
Yeah. So we're going to take another little bit of a musical musical break. This one is actually, because this is our Halloween episode, I figured I might play a theme from Halloween.
Oh, my God.
So,
I'm a scared.
You guys are going to be scared?
I'm a scared.
Good thing we have the lights on in the studio.
Okay.
So here we go. And we're back. It's 2 o'clock. We're
on the home stretch.
On the home stretch now. And we've been talking with, of course, this is Real Music on CKLU, 96.7 FM. And also in the studio with me today is one of my co-hosts is James.
Hello.
Hello. And, of course, we have also Rob.
Keeping it real.
Keeping it real.
Yeah.
Keeping it real.
So he's a zombie guy. I got a question.
Go for it.
Okay. Everything we know about zombies is how they act with people, right?
Sure.
Okay. What if it wasn't that way? What if zombies were nice and it was a reverse role where the humans are just killing zombies for no reason at all, but just because they're misunderstood?
Well, you know, yeah, I was going to say, even if they were nice, we'd find a way to kill them because that's what humans do. You know, humans want to kill stuff. You know, we're doing it to everything, really. You know, we'll find a way to kill anything we don't understand. I mean, you know, if you saw Bigfoot in the coming at you in the forest, he could be coming up to you to shake your hand. You'd probably blow his face off. You had a shotgun. Like, humans react negatively towards things they don't understand. That's kind of like, you know, a tale as old as time.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, I'm just wondering if they got the stories messed up. Maybe zombies are nice, and we're just worried. You know? We're worrying about them for nothing.
Well, we'll send you out. If there's zombies attacking, we'll send you out. We'll see. We'll test that theory.
So, earlier we were talking about one of the beauties of going to the movies is watching trailers. And we mentioned about the Iron Man. We went off on the whole Avengers thing.
Yeah.
But super hour.
Yeah.
jokingly, a couple weeks ago, I said, because we end up talking about superheroes, it just happens. It's not like we plan it. It just happens.
No, it just happens.
Yeah. So I jokingly said he should rename the show to the Superhero Hour of Power.
Yeah, yeah.
So
it's time for Avengers Hour with James and OJ.
So,
I didn't do nothing.
Okay. Okay. My sister had some trouble with that too.
Yeah.
A few weeks ago.
I'm just going to pull it out.
Whatever.
There.
So,
there's a million jokes for that, but anyway.
Yes. Queen family show. Okay.
I'm just going to pull it out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, earlier this week too, they also, because this is our Halloween show, and Halloween is just around the corner, and we were just talking about Cabin in the Woods,
Mm-hmm. And Rob just mentioned about how it's almost like Evil Dead. Mm-hmm. Got the four people going out to the cabin. Back on Wednesday, they released the trailer for the new movie, Evil Dead. And not just a regular trailer.
They released it already?
They released the trailer.
Really?
Yep.
I've not seen it, man.
And of all things, it's a red band.
Oh, wow.
So I was going to have an audio copy of it. But because we're not allowed to have swears on the air, there is a couple swears in it. So
really?
I could have edited it for you. I'm just saying. You could have asked earlier.
It was the last minute thing I was talking about. But there is a scene, like in the trailer, you'll see the trailer. There's, just to give you a heads up, there's no Ash.
Yeah, I knew that.
Yeah.
I knew that going in, yeah.
And they talked, I think it was last weekend at a Comic-Con, and they had a panel with Jane Levy, who is, she's actually in a movie this weekend called Fun Size. It has Victoria Justice in it, and
yes,
Chelsea Handler is in it.
Yeah, I'm not a fan
but,
of her.
But it's one of those teen movies that...
Right, yes, I've seen
it. So well, she's in it, and it's from this... You know what? I can't pronounce the guy's name. He is from Peru, or one of the South American countries.
Mm-hmm.
he got attention from Sam Raimi with a short film that he did with these he did a short film with these robots, flying robots, almost a la Sky Captain.
Yeah
The World Tomorrow. It's similar to that, like in essence, because that's how that one got started too,
right?
But he got attention by Sam Raimi and signed to a movie deal at the time, and it's like, okay, that's cool. It's like, don't know what movie he's going to do, and then all of a sudden, we're doing Evil Dead. And Sam, Rob Tappert, and Bruce Campbell are all producers on it.
Yeah.
Bruce was the one that, and Rob, were the two that were hands-on. There is no...
So it's gotta be good.
It's, when you say remake... Reboot. I don't think it really would apply to this one because this is
a new vision of it. I guess.
Vision.
Yeah.
And it's because we're not really allowed to say swears on the radio. I will say that this is balls out like a horror film. This is what you want from a horror film. And even Bruce Campbell has said that too. It's like, you want blood.
Yeah.
It's just like the AC/DC song. You want blood, you got it. And that's what this one is. There's a scene in the trailer where it looks like a hand is possessed. But it's more looks like a burn or something like that. But she takes one of those electric turkey carvers.
Yeah.
And just goes to... cuts up higher than you know, like the ash hand, but up higher. It's like
above the elbow.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Oh.
And then as fast as that happens, you see a guy with a chainsaw. So they had to put a chainsaw in there.
So is this sort of like played for laughs a little bit too?
No laughs.
So it's like serious horror.
Serious horror.
Dramatic horror.
From what I saw from the Red Band trailer,
yes,
it is a horror movie.
See, and that's one of the things I love the most about the Walking Dead show. Because that's like a dramatic horror show. It's not played for any laughs or anything. It's like straight ahead. And I find a lot of horror stuff is kind of done like that now, which kind of lessens the impact. So if Evil Dead's going to be like that, that's great. You know, that's a kind of a neat take on that. Because it's hard to do that kind of humor that they did with the original Evil Dead.
Yes.
And Evil Dead 2. That's, I mean, you can't redo that.
Yeah,
no. You know, that was magic, man. That was lightning in a bottle, you know?
Yeah, and that's one of the things that they filmed it in New Zealand because they had that big crew out there doing the Lord of the Rings and all that, too. And that's why they got the big
Wedded to do the effects?
I believe so.
Oh, yeah.
But they might have kept some of the guys from K&B because they were the guys that originated, as it were, Henrietta.
Yeah.
ships, yeah. And and that's of course like that's where Rob Tappert,
yep,
he lives out there anyway. That's where they filmed like Xena and all that,
yeah,
too.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so the trailer is online, and they got a release date of April 13th.
Yeah.
So like a year after Cabin in the Woods came out.
So the cabin's being used for something else this
time.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was also I figured I'd do a little bit of our business that we usually do on here, which is upcoming releases. This past weekend, this week, there is, like I mentioned, Fun Size came out this week, as well as the Wazowskis' Cloud Atlas. They've been working for years on this movie.
What do you think about that?
I think I'm not going to watch it. I think it doesn't seem like something I want to see.
I'm not huge into it. What do you think?
I've seen The Fountain, so I'm good.
You've seen it already?
No, I've seen The Fountain.
Oh, The Fountain. Oh,
that reminds me of it.
Is that right? Yeah.
Yeah, because it does a past, present, future
type
of thing.
Yeah.
And it's actually, they have three directors. Yeah. And it's the Wazowskis.
Yeah, Wazowskis.
And the director of, he did Run, Lola, Run.
Oh, yeah, right, yeah.
So
apparently what I understand from that movie is that song plays a lot in that movie.
Yeah, and that's the name of it. It's called Cloud Atlas. It's based off the book. And
I'm definitely not watching a movie with a whole bunch of same music in it. It's, if there's deja vu, that means there's a glitch in the Matrix. So.
Well put.
Yeah. So, of course, last week, Tom Hanks is in the movie.
Yeah.
And last week he was on the Today Show, and he dropped the F-bomb.
What?
Live on air.
No. Yeah.
Because they asked him, well, can you do a bit of the character? Can you? Well, he's a bit of an accent, and he goes right into it.
Well, he warned them, though, too. He said, if I do the voice, I might swear, and I don't want to do that. And they're like, oh, do it. You won't swear. And then, he ended up swearing.
What, does he sound like Keith Richards or something? Or
Bit of a...
Cockney.
Yeah, something like that, yeah. And he ends up, and as soon as he dropped it, he was like, oh my god, what did I do, type of thing. And even like the host, she was like in awe and everything, and right from then, he was like, right to blame the giving him the mic, because it threw things off, because he didn't, lapel mic wasn't working.
Yeah.
So he had the handheld.
Yeah.
And then he said, maybe next time we'll have a 7-second delay. Because there was no 7-second delay.
Right, It's live, baby.
So one of the other movies coming out that came out this week, too, was Chasing Mavericks.
Yeah, Chasing Mavericks.
With Gerard Butler.
Yeah.
Based on a true story.
I find his American accent so fake. And, like, you can still hear his accent in it, like his regular talking voice.
Anytime I see him, as Leonidas. This is Sparta.
Leonidas, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. So I mean, that's what everybody remembers. You know, he played Dracula, man, in Dracula 2000.
Yes.
You believe that?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I didn't know that.
Was it Carpenters or no? That was Vampires. That was Vampires. That crappy James Woods.
Yeah, they made a sequel to that with Bon Jovi too.
What? What?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah, John Bon Jovi was in the sequel.
Dying again.
Yeah. And then the other, they decided to put out a scary movie this weekend for Halloween, which is the sequel for Silent Hill.
Oh, God, that was
and
horrible.
And it actually looks better than the first one.
What?
I've heard stuff about this, because I listened to a lot of, like, podcasts and stuff.
Yeah.
And they interviewed the actress, and she said, out of the, I think there's like 13 or so evil whatever there is characters in there.
Yeah.
Only 3 of them were done with CG. Everything else was full on makeup everything else, which is pretty cool actually.
Because the effects that I did see on the commercial or trailer,
it looks like bad 3D.
It looks like Asylum did it or something. Yeah,
it's really bad. Yeah.
And we were when we first started the show, we were gonna have. Obviously, I contacted you, and it was perfect for you to confirm for today's date. And we had two other people were just trying to reschedule their work around their schedule as well. And my cousin Peter, you've met him.
Mm-hmm.
He was approached
last year sometime, like when they just about to do it, to do creature designs. I believe that's what it was, for Silent Hill.
Oh, okay.
But he couldn't do it because he was in production on something else.
Well, that's kind of like, yeah.
But he ended up doing, he was art direction on the Stephen Moyer movie, The Barons. It just came out last week. Actually, it came out on video on demand, then it came out on video. So I was going to try and have him on and talk about it. So we're working on a schedule with Peter to come on board again, and we have a few other guests lined up for November as well. And it is, I got to take another break.
Oh, come on now.
Sorry, yeah. Well, I got to do a few things. I got to request our other co-host that comes in once in a while too is my sister. I don't know if you ever met her. No.
No, I don't think so.
She was really looking forward to meeting you today because...
What?
Yeah.
Why would anyone in their right mind want to look forward to meeting me, really?
Who knows?
Look at me. It's a good thing it's a radio show, man.
But for a 10-year-old boy, you've...
I mean, pretty good.
Yeah.
So, we'll just say that the next show coming up, what's the name of it?
This Way Out.
This Way Out is coming up at 2:30. And we're going to play a request. My sister, she's, because of Remembrance Day coming up, she's involved with the Legion as well. She does the little newsletter that goes out to all the members for the Legion. And she's also designing the program for the services as well, coming up on November 11th.
Mm-hmm.
And so she's busy at home listening to us ramble on about superheroes.
You got to get your Casey Kasem voice out.
No.
No?
No, I'm not doing that.
This dedication goes out to Catherine. I don't know how to do it.
Yeah.
Coming up next.
That's so pretty that's what it is.
So I was going through all my the songs and the music I was going to play today. And it's like, going through, it's like, I really want to play some Canadian content. But there's nothing there. Two weeks ago I played some Howard Shore. Last week I played some Headstones. And he's Canadian. And he's on a show called Flashpoint, Hugh Dillon.
Oh, yeah, Hugh Dillon.
Yeah.
Big fan.
So, and because this is a Halloween show, we're going to play a song that she requested, and it's called Cemetery. So, go listen, and we'll be right back. And that was Headstones with Cemetery. And caught us off guard because we were talking off air. And
yeah.
We were talking about swears
because the show before us had a couple of little F-bombs.
But we'll keep it clean.
Yeah.
Keep it clean for the kids listening, you know?
Yeah.
And we're talking about movies out this weekend. I always like, my sister and I, we always do this. We go out Tuesdays and look out all the new releases that are on DVD. And this week, I figured I'd bring it up because it sounds like it's a horror story in itself. They're releasing the sequel. They made a sequel, and it's being released this Tuesday. Sequel to A Christmas Story. Yep, with little Ralphie.
No.
What?
Yes. Come on now.
Daniel Stern plays the dad now.
Oh, Daniel Stern.
The infamous lamp makes a return.
Come on.
And now, Ralphie is now
42.
No, now he's like 10 years later now. And he's in college or something like that.
Oh.
And he tries to, instead of getting the rifle, the BB gun, now it's a car.
Oh, man.
And his little brother, Randy, is the one who's given the cheesy pajamas now. And this time, instead of bunny pajamas, it's a little sailor suit. It's like,
so it goes back to the whole Hollywood has no good ideas anymore.
I'm going to let this groan out.
One of the other ones too that's coming out is one that played at Cinefest. I didn't get a chance to see it. It's called Safety Not Guaranteed, and it's a time traveling.
Oh, yes!
Yeah.
I heard really good things about
that. Yeah, so I didn't get a chance to see it at Cinefest. I'm glad it's finally coming out.
Super low budget, eh?
Yes.
But good, though. I heard.
Another one, too, since we're in the theme of Halloween.
They are re-releasing, and for the first time on Blu-ray, Rosemary's Baby.
Oh, one of my favorites, man.
That's, I believe that's Roman Polanski?
Yeah, Roman Polanski, yeah.
Which he won't set foot in on American soil anymore.
Well, he can't.
No.
Well, he really shouldn't, because he doesn't want to go to jail.
Yeah, now, indiscretions.
Yeah, but now, mind you, the woman that it happened to...
Yeah, she totally absolved him of everything.
Yeah, but it's the fact that it's a...
It's the law.
It's the law, so... And that's why he spent so much time over in Europe and everything, and...
I'm the law.
And it was funny, too, because he made an appearance in Rush Hour 3.
Yeah, that's weird, eh?
Yeah.
What the...
Because did you see it?
Yeah, I've seen Rush Hour 3, yeah.
When they went to France.
What, the Polanski?
Yeah.
Oh.
And they end up, because he was a French detective there, and you're not allowed to, and his French accent, as it were. Yeah, so that's coming up.
I love Polanski. I think he's great.
Now, of course, we'll also like to mention about movies that are coming out next weekend, because we are a Saturday show.
Yeah.
Robert Zemeckis has a new movie coming out called Flight.
Oh, the
Denzel Washington. Yeah, right. And John Goodman, who's been on a tear recently, ever since Red State.
Oh, yeah.
He's been in almost everything. He's been in Paranormal.
Isn't he in Argo?
He's in Argo right now.
He's in with the Paranormal Activity?
No, Paranorman.
Or Norman, oh.
Yeah, he does the voice of the uncle.
I've not seen it.
Yeah.
Is it good?
It's pretty good. Yeah, I took my nephew to see it.
I really want to see it.
First day.
Yeah.
And we saw it. We didn't see it. It wasn't... I'm trying to finish a sentence here. it wasn't a 3D version, but it was okay.
Oh, okay.
You know, like, it's okay not to be in 3D as well. But I'm watching it. Okay, cool. And my nephew... first time he sat next to me in a movie was Avengers.
Yeah.
And at certain points, my wife would turn over to me and see him perched up, like, really intense in the movie. But at the same time, I'm doing the same thing.
Yeah, of course.
Sort of thing. So
you love movies, man. Come on.
So and he's sitting again next to me, and I look over, and he's, like, really into it. You know?
Yeah.
And then it gets to a certain point where I had, like, one of those, what's going on here? Yeah. Like, it went from being a nice kids like scary movie type of thing where you take your kids to, you know, and then it just went like adult. Like I don't mean like
in sexually.
Like, no, but like you would see something like this in a live action movie that would only air like at 10 o'clock at night or something like that. It's like
What just
happened? And it was a nice little twist to it. It's like,
did you hear what happened to this down in the States? I'm not going to take too long. What happened down in the States is they actually messed up which movie was supposed to be playing at the time. So a whole bunch of kids in the theater
not that one.
Oh, no, but yes.
They were supposed to be playing a kids movie, and they ended up the projector.
They're supposed to be playing Frankenweenie?
It was another kids movie.
It's the one with Adam Sandler and all the voices and all that.
Hotel.
Yeah, they're supposed to play Hotel Transylvania. Yeah. Sorry, that's what I thought you were talking about for a second there. I spaced out Squirrel. And they ended up playing Paranormal Activity.
4.
Yeah.
What are those movies really scary? I haven't seen any of them.
I've seen 1 through 3, and I don't find them scary at all.
I would rather check Dom DeLuise's ball sack for lumps. you know.
Is that considered a swear?
No. I had to get ball sack in there somehow. I wasn't leaving the studio without saying it. You know what? I see the commercials for them, and it's like, no, this is not... These movies, this franchise is for... squealing children.
And you know what? A couple years ago, I worked at the theater when Paranormal Activity, the first one, was there.
Yeah.
And a lot of the kids were in there, freaked out. My daughter went and saw it, and she was absolutely spooked by it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, have you ever watched The Exorcist?
Yeah.
See,
like, come on.
These movies like, are for people who've never seen movies before.
Yeah. I watched The Exorcist, because when The Exorcist originally came out, hopefully I'm not making you feel old here, because you're 10, right?
You're 10.
But my mom was pregnant for me when The Exorcist came out in theaters.
Oh, okay.
So I didn't see that one, obviously. I was in her stomach, but...
I love that.
When I was about 20 or 21,
Yeah.
When the re-release came out?
Yeah, they put out a re-release with extra spoilers.
I was living at home. I was going to college, and every night, closed my door, turned off the lights, and after I seen that movie, my door was open, and I was spooked.
That'll leave an impression on you.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? Even Rosemary's Baby. Like, that movie will scare the life out of you, man. Because it's like everyone's against you.
Yeah.
You know? What's her name? Not Natalie. Who's Rosemary? Who's Rosemary in that movie?
It's Mia Farrow.
Mia Farrow. Everyone's against her. And I mean, you know, you watch that movie and you get paranoid, man. Anyway, sorry.
But the paranormal movies, I don't find them scary, but I know people, like my wife watches it and she's kind of spooked by it, but I don't find it spooky.
Yeah.
To me,
it was enough for people to go to the theaters. It almost, on its opening weekend, it almost made $30 million.
Yeah. And Hollywood loves it because it costs nothing to make.
And
so like $1 trillion.
Someone said it's an advanced Blair Witch project. That's what they said.
Yeah. Well, that's like who really started it, eh? Like this, not just that genre, but the genre of
found footage. Yeah.
Like even Apollo 13 that came out last year. Apollo 18.
Yeah.
Sorry. Right. All found footage.
Did you see it?
Yeah.
How was it?
It was okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not gonna write home about it.
Yeah, I'm not gonna go see it now because you're like, man, it's all right.
No, it was worth a watch.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And the one other movie that's coming out next week.
Nice segue.
Is
Man with the Iron Fist?
Yes.
Oh, I wanna see that.
Yeah.
Stars Ezra.
Yeah.
Who directed it.
What has he done before that?
He's Wu-Tang Clan.
I know, but what has he done before that movie-wise? Nothing.
No, it's his directorial debut.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's been involved with... he really likes this type of...
Genre.
Yeah. Genre. He was involved with music on the Sam Jackson animated show, Afro Samurai.
Afro Samurai, yeah.
And,
but he also directed, Wu-Tang videos. You can say that it doesn't count, but it kind of does count because he knows what he's doing. But
if
he wanted to do this, right?
Ezra, director, then you have to accept Mick G as a director then too.
Because there's a lot of people I don't consider director.
I don't know. I think a lot of people's minds will be blown away by this movie. I'm gonna go see it for sure, and I think a lot of people will are gonna be like, where did this guy come from?
Yeah, a lot of people they know that I'm big into movies as well, and they said. So what's this new Quentin Tarantino movie?
Yeah.
This with the kung fu. It's like, no, that's not Quentin Tarantino. Yeah, it's his name.
I love that.
He produces it. He's a producer on it.
Yeah.
Even that, like, he was what was it? Hostel was under his name as well as Cabin Fever.
Yeah.
And they're just
because Eli Roth did those.
Yeah. And and then the other movie that's coming out too is another kids movie. To go on the side with, to keep people going to the theaters with their kids.
Oh, man.
To take the pressure away from Hotel Transylvania, because we've been selling out. That show's been selling out. But this one is called Wreck-It Ralph.
Oh, yeah, that looks not bad.
And it's based off of a fictitious 30-year-old video game arcade game. And they've actually been putting out, false trailers, commercials.
Oh, okay.
And one is from 1982. And the bad tracking on it looks like it's from VHS.
Yeah.
So,
that's cool.
Yeah. Good. So those are the movies coming out, and I believe we're almost out of time here.
Yeah.
Almost out of time.
It's not enough time, right?
Yeah. But I mean, if you really like the show, like we said earlier in the show, you can go to anotherpodcast.com and re-download it there, and you can listen to the podcast that OJ and I do, and. On Friday, we're going to have this episode up with all of Rob's stuff on there. All the links, everything, where you can get in contact with him.
Much obliged.
Yeah, because he's got some good stuff going on.
Thank you very much.
Definitely. And, of course, this has been Real Music. I'm your host, OJ, with...
James.
And, of course, our special guest...
Rob Sacchetto.
There we go. And it's been a blast. And keep it real till for another week. Have a good week, folks.
Bye.
Thank you.